I'm not going to talk about bank. I'm going to talk about food. Which makes you wonder probably why someone from a bank talking about food, right? I realized that Rabobank is not as famous as OCBC, Citi, so I think I have to do a little bit of introduction. So the mission of our bank is to provide food for the growing population. You see that 2020 may be a more mouth to feed and less less food to provide. So we only focus on food and agribusiness sector. So we have around 80 research professionals across 16 offices. And my main focus is in consumer foods. So I myself, I have spent about 12 years in food companies in Indonesia. I handled brands. Actually, I was a brand manager before I moved to Consumer Insight, and now I'm in a bank, but still talking about food. So my topic right now is talking about cultural blunders. So you might be seeing this a lot in the internet, right? Some brands doing some silly mistakes. Sounds funny, but if you think about it, probably it's going to cost a lot for the brand because you see some example. For example, Clairol. They introduce a curling iron in Germany. The brand is Mist Stick, which means that in Germany, mist is a slang for manure. Also, American Motors, they launch a car called Matador, which means killer in Puerto Rico. You don't want that for a car, right? And then KFC, they translate their finger licking good into Chinese, but end up eat your fingers off. Another one, in Mexico, gut milk. They translated gut milk into, are you lactating? So, and these are my, this is my favorite. Nothing sucks like an Electrolux. The thing is that if only that cultural blunders are that obvious, it's very easy for you to, you know, to fix things, right? Oh, right, I'm doing a wrong brand naming. I have to do something else. I have to change the brand name. But most of the cultural blunders were not that obvious. You only realize after a few years in the market, the brand is not growing. You see sales never took off. And then you start to audit what happened, what went wrong. And sometimes you point at the wrong direction, right? It could be maybe the product is not good enough, the taste. Maybe it's the salespeople. But could be that the whole root cause is actually from culture. So there are some possible causes, you know, like strategy or management related factors. Could be also macro environment related factors. Could be both. Because, you know, when you enter a new market, I used to work in a local company. And we had some projects for markets outside Indonesia, India, other Southeast Asia, China even. So we started usually with this process as a brand owner. So if you were a brand manager, you have people from your consumer insight department digging, trying to find the human truth. And then you cook it. You try to segmentize, you target, you position the brand. And then you have this brand essence, right? Usually you have the brand essence starting from your home market. You do the brand essence in Indonesia, and then you have the brand essence that is actually originally coming from understanding the Indonesian market, or, well, Singapore or any country for that matter. Then from the brand essence, you develop the personality of the brand. Then you translate into the marketing strategy. You have the four P's, like the classic one: product, communications, channel, pricing. Then you translate again into the execution part. You have the packaging, you have the product formulation, you have the media, you have the creative materials, you have the product display. And then packaging, you have the design, you have the material, you have the format, products, you have the appearance, flavor, raw material, and everything. But the thing is that what your consumers see is not the brand essence. You never speak about brand essence here. This is not the brand essence of Chayatama, I think. This is the tagline. You don't speak the brand essence in the advertising, right? You translate it into some communication materials. But what your consumers see is actually this, all of this area. So this is your only touch point with the consumers. From there, they will try to translate your brand message. They will try to decode the brand message. And the problem will arise when you put the materials into a different context, different culture. Let's see from the consumer point of view. I'm taking this from a theory called coordinated management of meaning. So they start by receiving content, right? So they have, they receive the raw data, information, but this is not enough. Content is never enough because people will try to make meaning from the content that they receive. So there are speech act behind that. So how is the tone of the communication? What is the semantics, syntactics, and those kind of things? And then behind speech acts, there are episodes. What are the contexts in which they act? So if you say, someone say to you, I love you. If the person who speaks about it is your mom, and your wife, and your boss, it's all totally different context. So the episode itself will also depend on the contract. What is the boundaries between you and the communicator? And then going deeper is the life script. What is your role? What is your character? How you see yourself in the world? And then on the very fundamental part is the cultural pattern itself. What is the archetypes or the your view of the world, the broad images of you compared to that order? So there are some cultural universals, right? Some elements that prevails across culture. You see, in any culture, there are food taboos, there are games, there are medicine, there are surgery and everything. But the belief and also the practice can be very different across cultures. For example, food taboos. In Japan, it's okay to slurp the soup. It's even considered enjoying the food. But if you do this in Indonesia, people will frown at you. It's considered impolite. Now I want you to try to guess what are the brands here. The first one, KFC, good. The second one, anyone? This is for in Indonesia, yeah, I'm talking about Indonesian context. McDonald's, that's good. The third one, it's getting tougher. The third one is Burger King. You didn't see Burger King selling fried chicken in any other parts of the world, only in Indonesia. What about the fourth one? The fourth is Pizza Hut. The fifth, no, no price for that, of course, definitely. So if you see Indonesian eating culture, I'm talking about how people try to fulfill their empty stomach, right? You see any similarities between all of these? Rice. Indonesians cannot live without rice. So it is very ingrained into Indonesian culture, you know, that Indonesian is are actually fourth highest consumer of rice in the world. So per capita consumption is 134 kilograms in a year. I cannot imagine that I have eaten 4 sacks of rice in a year, wow. And you see that in English, rice is rice. But in Indonesia, there are different names to rice. Before, when it's planted, it's called padi. When you harvest it, it's gabah. When you have milled it, it's beras. And when you have cooked it, it's nasi. But in English, it's all rice. And then what is funny about Indonesians is that snack is loosely defined as anything that is not rice. So you haven't had any meal yet if you do not eat rice. So someone can have 2 slices of pizza, and you can ask him, have you had lunch today? No, I haven't. I just had 2 slices of pizza for snacks. So that is so Indonesian. There are myths also, rituals. We have Dewi Sri. Maybe Indian fellows also can relate to this. This is the rice goddess symbolizing fertility also. Also, you have rice harvesting rituals and also festival across local ethnicities in Indonesia. A lot of things, but still revolving around rice. Now, maybe also Indonesia is the only place where there is one day no rice policy. So we eat too many rice that the government wants to stop us from eating rice. It's that bad. So I'm trying to put this into some semiotic thinking framework. Mind you that this is just a few days of work, so if we want to do something in detail, maybe we can have a project after this. So if you look at the residual codes, what was probably has passed is that Indonesians also, we have rantang or tiffin box. So in the past, farmers going to the rice fields, they will bring these tiffin boxes for lunch. Also, communal eating was very popular in Indonesia. So one big, we call it tampah, yeah, or a big, very big plate, and where people eat together from the same plate. Also, rice was originally from Java. In eastern part of Indonesia, people are eating different types of carbs. So it can be yam or sagu or anything. But now, I think most of Indonesians are very accustomed to having rice. Even in Papua, they also grow rice in Papua as well. And there was a concept of 4 healthy and 5 perfect. It's like a pyramid. So in the bottom part, once again, is rice. And on the top part is milk. So see that why Indonesian, we eat so many rice and drink so less milk. Because culturally, we are accustomed to see that rice is the basic necessity and milk is like a luxury. Now, the dominant culture is the rice-based meal. So yeah, like that McDonald's and all the fast food examples, if they don't sell any rice-based meal, it's hard for them to compete and survive, right? And then the fast food culture, it's dominant in Indonesia. And what I call instant export. Maybe Unilever can capitalize this very well. Because, of course, instant noodles is number one. And also that right now, housewives, they are very accustomed to having this pre-made ingredients. So they can do any kind of dishes from the pre-made ingredients. They don't need to start from scratch. And it saves a lot of time. What is emerging right now, I see that there is a revival of local cuisine in Indonesia. So a lot of traditional snacks are being repackaged into more modern approach, even traditional food. And also the concept of balanced nutrition is emerging in Indonesia. Food delivery, thanks to Gojek, probably one of the best startup in Indonesia. And also the East Asian mania. You see a lot of Korean, Japanese food in Indonesia right now. This, I put this in the fulfill space. Then there is something called sustain, because sometimes you don't have enough time to have a complete meal. So Indonesians will try to manage by eating something that is less fulfilling, so only to sustain to the next meal time. So what is residual is first is fasting. Well, Muslims, we have to fast for the whole month, but I don't see too many Muslims now fasting outside this fasting month, although it's actually suggested to do so. And then there is a Javanese idiom that is called mangan ora mangan asal kumpul, which means togetherness is above full stomach. So you don't see Indonesians working outside Indonesia too many, because it is very important for Indonesians to be together. So you may have a very low-paying job that maybe not giving you enough food, as long as you're still staying together in the family. And then the dominant codes in sustain is fried snacks. We call it gorengan. So anything fried is a snack for us. And then bakeries, modern bakeries, you see it coming up. Also liquid meal, hot cereals. And then the emerging trend is on the go and the energy bar. So we can see that the culture of the empty stomach itself is moving from maintaining local wisdom, local harmony, and then moving to pragmatic and practical solutions, which is now a dominant code. And then the emerging trend is the wellness and exploration. So this is the journey, the cultural journey that is happening in Indonesia when it comes to trying to fulfill an empty stomach. Now, there are some brands who try to challenge the rice dominance. So trying to give some alternatives to the consumers. Can we play the video? Yeah.
Kita akan gogok makan. Mulai. Kita gogok makan.
He's on strike. He's on hunger strike actually.
Kok? Kan mogok makan, nggak mogok minum.
Minum aja kok tetap segar.
Ini kan jelly drink dari Oki. Ini bukan minuman jeruk biasa, ada jelinya. Oki Jelly Drink, pelepas dahaga, jelinya menunda lapar.
So this brand is actually a bit unique because it is actually a beverage, but it has a jelly content in it, but because it's not as thick as jelly, so you can actually slurp the jelly. What is unique about it is that they try to put themselves as a meal replacement. So something like emergency meal replacement. And it's quite successful. The ad is actually from 10 years back. If you see the product, it's very cheap, 500 rupiah. I think it's less than a half cent, I think, in US dollar. So, and the texture, because it's jelly, is quite fulfilling. And it's also a beverage at the same time. So people who have less money, they can have some solution in both beverage and also food at the same time. So this was quite successful until recently. And we also see some other brand, international brand as well. You see this ad in Indonesia about 2011. It's not this one, it's the other one. Yeah, next. Sorry.
Yeah.
Dia mulai lapar.
Dia mulai lapar.
Dia mulai lapar.
Mulai lapar.
Diam!
Memperkenalkan Snickers. Coklat lezat dengan kacang dan karamel. Nolong lo di saat kelaparan. Mulai lapar, ambil Snickers.
So, you may be able to guess where the ad came from, right? It's adopted from India. And Indonesians are very fond of football, definitely. But somehow this ad did not connect with Indonesian consumers. So it reached a very, probably not so good reception among the consumers. They don't actually relate this ad because, you know, the real football scene in Indonesia, it's like this. Well, you don't see the ball, you see the foot there. Yeah. Yeah, football is a male sport, right? And from that ad, you see the keeper, he was hungry, and then someone opened a tiffin box and throw the product to the keeper. But the thing is that in Indonesia, tiffin is actually a residual culture, and I don't think that Indonesian males have this tiffin box let alone to a football match. So I've seen football myself. There are satay senders, offenders in the stadium. So you don't see people carrying this kind of tiffin boxes into the stadium. It will be raided by other supporters, I think. So somehow the brand does not connect because some of the elements in the ad is a foreign concept to Indonesians. It's a residual idea to Indonesians. So we see now Snickers, they have this campaign that you are not you when you are hungry, right? So they try to move from the space of just feeling hunger into more emotional, hangry. People angry because they are hungry, right? This is Indonesian version as well.
Mobil macam apa ini? Lambat, kayak sepo. Sempit lagi. Singkirin nih.
Badan lu aja gede.
Hah? Hey, badan gede nih badan.
Riz, nih makan sneakers.
Kenapa?
Lu rese kalau lagi lapar. Mendingan?
Mendingan?
Karena lapar, berubah orang. Sneakers, coklat lezat dengan kacang dan karamel. Lapor, ambil sneakers.
Membosankan. Pas.
So you may not know the language, but the tone is very different to the previous ad. So people, when they are hungry, they are not themselves. They became, a different person. Even to the point that they are becoming an antagonic person, right? So Snickers were very successful in doing this. You see that they even in the US changed the brand name into this sleepy, sneepy, impatience, all the emotions or causes or symptoms when you're hungry. So the question is that now they are moving from culturally irrelevant to a higher space of emotions, right? So the question is whether emotions are universal across culture. This is my favorite way of describing emotions. You see, some people say there are 5 basic emotions, others 8, but the question remains whether the emotions are the universal language. Some interesting example I will give you is this one. This is from Coca-Cola. So they had this study, I think, 3 or 4 years ago. They find different cultural tensions across the world. Still, that the brand essence of Coke is happiness and optimism. But the way they execute the brand message was to find the cultural tensions and try to play around it. So there is a fear among people right now that good people outnumber bad people. Sorry, the other way, bad people outnumber good people. You see ISIS, you see all of these wars. Relate to any culture. People can understand the emotion behind it, that they are offering optimism, they are offering happiness. But still, Coca-Cola feel the need to translate into a local language, local culture. This is the Indonesian version. You might not know the language once again, but you will feel the same emotion. Traffic jam, you will be the data. Wow, come on. So again, emotions are universal, of course. But the way to translate into the cultural context needs to be thought of also. There is a theory called affect valuation. So my question is whether emotions are universal across cultures. Is there any impact of culture to emotions or the other way around? And this theory say that the cultural factors, they shape how people ideally want to feel more than how they actually feel. It's quite interesting theory. So the first premise that the physiological response to emotional events are similar across cultures. When you're shy, your face are getting red, maybe you stoop a bit. But the facial expressive behavior across culture are different. So if the brand are talking about physiological responses, you can execute in a different manner between Western and Eastern culture. The second one is that in every culture, people try to suppress the emotion. But the culture, they influence the consequences of suppression for the psychological well-being. So Asians are very good at managing internal conflicts. So they are OK with being good and bad at the same time, having that feeling, but not Westerners. So the way this suppressing emotions can have a different impact to Westerners compared to Asians. And then people feel good during positive events, but culture influences whether people feel bad during the positive events. You see some Asian cultures where they don't feel good of being successful. They want to be humble. They want to be at the background, not at the forefront. And also, people want to feel good across cultures, but the good states that people want to feel are different. So Westerners probably more open, more animated, more alive, while Asians tends to be more calm, not showing emotions too much, but still the feel-good feeling is there. And also that people base the happiness on similar factor, but the way that that is put on each factor is different. So this should be the base also in how to execute the emotional approach. So this is my last two slides. It's how to translate the cultural insights into the relevant codes. So there is a theory called multimodality. So it's part of communication and social semiotics theory. So brands, essentially, they create meaning by communicating through multimodes. So it could be visual, could be spoken, gesture, and everything. And you know that separate modes, they actually constitute an inseparable whole. There is a theory of gestalt psychology, for example. And meanings always relate to a specific societies and their cultures. So in short, that multimodality, they enable us to design a brand that considers all elements as a meaning-making tools. So this is an example of how Oreo, they've been successful in trying to respond to the Chinese culture. So Oreo originally is a chocolate sandwich, right? Chocolate with the vanilla filling sandwich. And they found out that in China during summer, their sales was not so good because there is a concept of hot and cold in China, heaty and cooling. So like the yin yang, maybe in East Southeast Asian culture as well. But chocolate in China is highly associated to heaty stuff. So that is why that people in summer, they don't eat Oreo because summer is hot and chocolate, they cause heatiness. So what they did was actually they launched a vanilla and green tea ice cream flavor in China, which is very smart. What Oreo maintains, the heritage of the brand remains the lick and dunk. But they changed the whole product because they think that the product by itself cannot survive in China's Chinese culture. So looking back into sneakers, whether it's relevant or not for them to maintain the product, of course, it depends on the decision of the brand owner, right? Because you see, from all of this, front-facing elements of your brand, there are some that might be relevant, some that are very easy to change to make it in tune with the culture, but some others you consider it as a heritage you don't want to change at all. For example, say the color of the brand. Purple, for example, in Indonesia is considered as a color of widow. So if your brand is in purple color, whether it's relevant or not, remains a question whether you want to change the color. Also, the product, Snickers is always well known for the product, the chocolate nougat. Whether they want to change the product or not remains their choice. So there is no shortcut or easy answer whether you want to maintain the heritage of the brand, because sometimes you have to redefine that heritage. You should know that in a new culture where your brand try to enter, they don't have the heritage in that culture, right? So it's up to you on how to choose which elements of the brand that you want to maintain and which elements of the brand that you want to change to in order to make it relevant to the culture. So, terima kasih.